Hi, everybody. It's Tuesday evening, so that means it's 6 o'clock, and we're here at All Things Brunswick. And we want to welcome you back, reminding you that you can see us live. If you want to look at these wonderful faces and Dan's, you can tune in and look at All Things Brunswick, or go to actually the Big Talker Live, or you can see us on YouTube as these shows get replayed forever and ever. So you can see our gorgeous faces and Dan's anytime you tune in.
1 week away, and this is where we're going to go.
This is where we go. But anyway, I want to welcome you back. I'm Bill Moore. I'm back healthy and stubborn and probably more obnoxious than before. And?
And we're glad.
Thank you for having me back. Thank you.
We are. And I'm Mary Stillwell.
And apparently I'm Dan the Awesome Man. How's that? And modest, too.
Grandeur is an important part of you.
It is.
So we agree to that.
It is.
We have a very, very important and very special guests, two of them, actually, that are here today. One is more of a support. She kicks her husband to keep him from getting in too much trouble. And I understand how that works because we're all married here. And but anyway, Mary, do you want to introduce our guests?
Absolutely. I would like to welcome Jonathan and Hope. I am not going to destroy their last name, so I will ask them when they speak to let us know what that is, and I apologize, but thank you so much for joining us. We have so many questions for you. Something that Jonathan said the very first time that I met him that has stayed with me ever since. He is Venezuelan by birth, and he is an American by choice. I love that.
Well, thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you so much.
And do you want to tell him your last name?
Yeah, so the first question I had was, how do you say your last name?
Okay. My name is Jonathan Uzcategui.
Uzcategui.
So if you have a problem pronouncing the last name, it sounds like, who's got the key?
Ah.
So if you say, who's got the key, it sounds like Uzcategui. It's Basque. My family are originally from, some of my family from Spain. It's a Basque.
The Basque region?
Basque, yes.
That's interesting. That
wonderful.
Yes.
Can you start by telling us a little bit about yourself and how long you have lived in the United States?
Well, I want to start by, once again, my name is Jonathan Uzcategui. I'm an American citizen by choice, Venezuelan by birth. And I came to the United States over 20 years ago. I used to go back and forth, and things got a little hard to go back to Venezuela. And then I decided to stay permanently in the United States as my home.
Wonderful. You have concerns about what is happening here in relationship to what happened in Venezuela. Is that correct?
That's correct.
You want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think we need to start maybe getting a little bit of education here on, talk a little bit of the history of Venezuela.
Okay,
right?
That's a good great.
Venezuela was a nation that got, we got our independent day 35 years after the United States of America got their independent, and a day also after the United States got their independent. Our founding fathers came to the United States to collect a lot of things and they brought to Venezuela. Like, we were a republic with three branches of the government. We had a constitution. And what we did different than the United States, it was that, see, when United States declared their independence, people asked George Washington to become the king and keep United States in a monarchy. He refused that idea and became our first president for two terms, right? We went the opposite way. We allowed the generals, after our independence, to become the leaders into the earlier 1960s. So Venezuela went in a bad direction for what I look. We had dictators. We had dictators all the way to the 1960s. Early 1960s, so that's what happened to Venezuela. It was into the 1960s, early 1960s, when we decide to take down our last dictator. His name was Marcos Perez Jimenez. And what happened after that, I believe, is something, you know, a lot of people in Venezuela don't realize that happened. I started to understand that better when I moved to the United States, because in here I learned exactly what it's like to be in a free country when I moved here, and, you know, learning all these beautiful things that this country provides, the freedoms, the liberties that we have that don't come from the men, it come from God. I also got to meet Jesus Christ in this country. It was I was saved when I moved to the United States.
Great.
So a lot of things happened to me when I moved here. But going back to the history of Venezuela, so what happened to us in Venezuela was that we do something I believe conservatives tend to do very well. It's minding our own business. We don't like to be in politics, right? But when we took down that last dictator, we started implementing democratic elections and the rule of law by implementing the republic, the constitution, the branches of government, and everything. We went in to do what we do better, like take care of our family, build business, pray God, you know, be on our own. In the same time, the other side wanted to stay in power. So what these people put in plan was to indoctrinate and take over our academia. So that's what I see similar to what's happening right now in the United States. The academia in Venezuela got completely taken over by the Marxists, the communists.
So you're seeing a parallel.
It's a very, very similar parallel of what happened over there. So we started producing these people in Venezuela, well-educated professionals, right? They were the ones that push agendas in Venezuela. Think about this. Venezuela, it took 50 years from Marco Perez Jimenez to Hugo Chavez. So you talk to a lot of, I talk to a lot of Venezuelans, right? So-called professionals. And anytime you ask him about Marcos Perez Jimenez, they always have great things to say about him. Mm-hmm. Because he did great things in Venezuela. Like, he was like, to me, like, looking at the history of Germany with Adolf Hitler came to power. He built a lot of bridges, roads. He put a lot of people to work. Perez Jimenez did the same exact thing. You know, he put a lot of people to work. He built a lot of houses, affordable housing, hospitals, stadiums, airports. I mean, the man did a great infrastructure projects in Venezuela. They still, to today, you see those projects in Venezuela. Mm-hmm. But we forgot to tell the atrocities that you saw with something we call La Seguridad Nacional, as a national security police. That what they did was, how many people got disappeared? How many people got killed? How many people got imprisoned because you didn't agree with the dictatorship? So yes, the Venezuelans, the majority of the Venezuelans that I talk, that they talk to me about Perez Jimenez, I let them speak and then I tell them, so, well, let's talk about the atrocities that Perez Jimenez implemented during his regime. And sometimes they're like, oh, well, I don't know about that. Yeah, because the academia didn't tell that history. They tell all the great things, but they never say the bad things. So that's what happened. When you don't teach the proper history, it was going to always tend to repeat itself. So that's what I saw and I understood better when I moved here and started digging more into our history and understanding a little bit more politics in Venezuelan politics. And then now I'm able to put that together here. So 50 years for Chavez to get there, we use the narrative that they use for the first Marxist revolution was the industrial revolution, where we were preaching and talking about the men, the rich man is getting richer and the poor man is getting poor, that mm-hmm. narrative, you know. Mm-hmm. It's stupid a narrative because somebody's getting rich right now, I'm not getting poor, you know. So I just don't believe in that. And especially since I moved to this country, I've been living a very, you know, great life since I moved here. I may open many, many business. I live very, very well in this country. So somebody getting rich, it never affect my life, right? But that's how the revolution that we have in Venezuela was a cultural revolution based on that old narrative, the industrial revolution, Marxist revolution. In United States, you have a different revolution very similar, but it's a little different. Now we are implementing things like diversity, equity, and inclusion. And this is something that I used to have a lot of pushback back in the day. I started talking like that, like this 10 years ago. And I have a lot of pushback back then. People will say, Jonathan, that would never happen here. We're going to do this. We're going to do this. I say, okay, well, that's fine. Good. Good for you. I hope you're right and I'm wrong. I would love to always be wrong about that because this is home to me. I can never go back to Venezuela. And today.
You wouldn't let you.
Probably not, especially if they find out how vocal I am about the Nicolas Maduro regime and how I was against Hugo Chavez. So I'm pretty sure you're right, Bill. They would not let me. Even if I go, they will find a way to probably put me in jail.
You'd label one
me
of those
as a political prisoner.
Yeah. We would find a way not to let you get on the plane. Yeah. So let's start there.
Yeah, really. Well, I had a guy from American Boys News that he wants to take me back to Venezuela so we can do a report. I always said, brother, you don't want to go there. So he's like, Jonathan, we got to go. He interviewed me this past weekend when I was in the Trump rally. And he was like, Jonathan, do you think we can go? I said, no, that's not happening. So, but going back to what I was saying to you guys is that, so that's what happened. It was not the people that put Hugo Chavez in power. I believe it was just the very wealthy, the elite, those so-called professionals. The chronic capitalism put Hugo Chavez in power. Mm-hmm. Why? Because once again, they didn't. They put Chavez like the savior. They use all our symbols of patriotism in front with Chavez. It's like, think about it. Like, thank God that the Marxists here are so stupid, and it's a great thing they're that stupid. They hate our symbols of patriotism. If you really wanted to take a nation, you use those symbols of patriotism, and people will fall for whatever. Because there's nothing to me much better for the patriotism the people have. But that's how we did it. Chavez did that. He was very smart guy, very, very slick.
And that's something that people don't talk about. You know, I remember when, I believe it was Trump, you know, gave Putin credit for some of the things he did. And of course, you know, Putin's an evil person without question. Mm-hmm. But people were like, no, he's not. He's dumb. He's, no, these are not dumb people. These are highly intelligent. They know what they're doing. They're evil. Mm-hmm. Without question, they're evil. But they're not dumb. They know what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, they are. Like Chavez, you know. See, the thing that the people that put Chavez in power, right, they really thought in their head that they were going to be able to control this guy. Mm-hmm. So we put him in power, we'll be on control of everything, and we'll keep doing our thing. When Chavez understood how much power he had, they all got in their planes and came to the United States and went to Europe.
Wow. So they left the country.
Of course.
Yeah.
So who were these people? These people that put him in charge, they were they communists or
no,
not?
No. See, the thing is that and we need to understand how this work. They always had this great idea. Say, oh, we want to bring equity and inclusion for everybody, and we want to take care of you, and we want to do all these great things. But it's for you, not for us. It's always like that. Mm-hmm. In reality, they want us to be equally miserable. This is how these people do. The same thing that I see here. Who's pushing socialism? The wealthy. As the wealthy in this country, they're pushing socialism to your throat because we need it, because we're stupid and we just don't know how to take care of ourselves. And look, as the elite in Hollywood.
Well, you know, and that ties to my old flame, because as an old history teacher, mm-hmm. and I'll use the word old, I used to teach the fact that, you know, we have a globalistic economy based on our elite. Because they own the multinational companies, mm-hmm. you know, yep. and the problem with the United States is, as long as the United States has its exceptionalism, we are number one in the world. it defeats the one world direction they're going, a UN that runs the world.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and the best thing they can do for the world is to take us down and make us like the rest of the world.
Exactly.
And we can't let that happen. And I know you have lived through it, and you're going to do your best here to make sure it doesn't happen.
Oh, you betcha, Will, that I will put my life on the line for this country.
Wow.
So let me ask you this, because this is a question I have. For the average Venezuelan now, just so people can understand, what is their life like? Not the elites, not the people in power, the you and me's of Venezuela.
Sure. Well, we have now the biggest exile in Venezuela. Millions of Venezuelans have fled the country. They're all over the world. There's a lot of here. I know a lot of lawyers, doctors, engineers, architects. You know, they're living now here doing construction work. You know, simple jobs like working in a gas station. And there is nothing wrong with that. But these people are professionals. They went to school. They were well-educated doing these jobs now here, starting from square one. Because what we did in Venezuela, well, I'm not saying what we did, what they did in Venezuela. A lot of people realize after that happened, you know, they made a mistake. Because once again, the people that are pushing this idea, they always disguise their real true intentions. They always make it look like they really want to do something great for the communities. That's what they're doing here. Like if you see right now what's going on in this country, where what I believe the new way to take over a country is the 21st century revolution, is a culture revolution. Like, yes. Venezuela. So what you see right now in Russia, in Ukraine, it's not going to stick. You don't take a country these days anymore like that. People will fight against this.
And we're seeing that.
Exactly. That's the proof. I keep telling people, this will always be the case in the 21st century.
Because they tried it in the 20th century when they had the communists take over the unions, et cetera, in the 30s mm-hmm. and 40s, and they realized they could not overthrow by force.
Exactly.
So what they sit down and they did is they set up the long game. Let us take over education. Let us take over training for lawyers and whatever else. Mm-hmm. Let's take over journalism training.
Mm-hmm.
Once we control all those pieces, and we control everyone being taught and we control their minds.
Exactly. That's what we did in Venezuela. Think about it, the professionals, right? When you have a doctor pushing an agenda, a lawyer, an architect, a pastor, an engineer, they're the ones that are pushing the agenda in Venezuela. You're more likely to listen to the person because that person supposedly is well-educated. But in reality, if you close those books, they're dumb as a bucket mm-hmm. because they don't have common sense. This is what I saw over there. This is exactly the same thing that I see here. Think about it. Like, you can go over Barnes & Noble, right, in the library. When you look into a library person, they're supposed to be well-educated to let you know about books and recommend this, recommend that, right? There are people that are supposedly very intellectual, they read a lot. But if you go to one of those places right now, the majority of the books are pushing is liberal, mm-hmm. progressive agenda. That's not smart for us to learn one side of everything. We have to learn liberal and conservative, and we as a people decide what you want will make us happy. And they're failing on that. The media is doing something horrible. Venezuela 2.0, pushing an agenda. They're no longer informing the population. I believe the media is supposed to be the watchdog of the people. So when we fail to have the watchdog of the people watching over us, we're in trouble. They're
big
pushing
trouble.
Big trouble. So that's the problem that I see here. I look at it right now. We have, and these people are smart. They are really scaring me sometimes. Like, it's like playing whack-a-mole. Every time you identify a problem and you catch them doing that, they take it back, repackage, and come out with a different name. Yeah. See, Marxists are really good in linguistics. They're the experts on that.
Right.
To take something, when you identify mm-hmm. their intentions, they take it back, repackaged with a different name, but it's always the same intention.
Mm-hmm. And then they find a way to blame it on the opposite side for doing
exactly.
it.
Exactly. It's called political projection. You know, I'm going to blame you for the things that I'm doing. By the time we all realize what's really going on, it's too late. We're all confused. Mm-hmm. Added to the media is not actually reporting the news, and we're in trouble. We're like, okay, chaos. And they feed on chaos. Like what I see right now, the diversity. The diversity is a plan, like climate change, diversity, inclusion, equity. This is all Marxist 101 to me.
It's straight out of Marxist.
Exactly,
yes,
because see,
it, to me,
and this is something that I tell a lot of people that I have when I go, I was saying, where was that place we were that I gave in a speech and a lady got up and said, no, that would never happen here. What was it called? Guilford County. I started giving my speech and I said, and this is inevitable. But United States are, what I believe, 1 to 2 generations to become a communist state if we don't do something. The good news that I feel we have 1 or 2 generations to turn this around. That's the good news. This is not going to happen tomorrow or in 2 years or 10 years. Because once again, they're not going to do this takeover by force. They want to completely surrender of the people to go to the polls and elect a communist president. But it's had to be done by reshaping who we are as Americans. And where do you see that? On the inclusion part. The inclusion is where it tells you where we're hitting. Mm-hmm. Because the diversity is not sticking. The diversity is about race. But they're losing. It's right now in life support. I am the living proof of that. Look, I am a Venezuelan person, a foreigner, an immigrant, but I'm talking about American principles. Mm-hmm. I am defending the American way of life.
Right.
So they're having a trouble because, like me, there's a lot. The proof is Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson, and more people like me, they're rising up and said, not on my watch. So they are seeing that that's going to be a problem for them. So they always have to have contingency plans. When one plan doesn't work, the next one will come out. It's like playing whack-a-mole. You kill it here, they come up over there. You hit in there, they'll come up over here. So it's going to take for us to be well-educated on this. The diversity and equity inclusion got passed unanimously everywhere in the local, the state, federal level. Why? Our size, I give the benefit to our size to, one, didn't recognize what this was. Two, they didn't want to be called racist and homophobia and those this and that. So I give them that. But now people like myself are rising up and understand very well what these people's intentions are. Believe me, I am not going to have a problem to call this out when I see it.
Don't you think, Jonathan, that this is actually a cultural revolution?
Exactly.
And it is a slow process because with a cultural revolution, it kind of creeps up behind you. They try to process it very slowly, like with our education. And so before people really know what's going on, they kind of have their foot in the door.
Well,
so to speak.
That's what we did. It was a culture. The 21st century takeover of the nation is in a culture way. Take the culture. The culture is part of the history. The culture is everything, who we are. So if you chain the culture, you chain the history, you chain the history, you chain the narratives of how you want people to think, how you want them to act. So this is what we have. And like I was saying, the diversity is not sticking. The equity is there, always in the middle, ready to go, you know? But to me right now is the inclusion. The inclusion is their best weapon. But don't forget about the climate alarmists. Don't forget about the diversity, too, because in any given time, they will activate
that. They pull that card out when they need it.
Racist. Yep. And remember, we're doing this because we want all of us to be equity taken care of. I mean, equally miserable. That's what I always say. But the inclusion, it is the weapon that I've been keeping an eye for a long time. Why? That's the best weapon these people have. Think about, I was doing something with my wife. We were translating some books for, what was the
Education. our pavement education project.
Pavement education project. They contact us and they wanted me to translate some books for the school system. These books are in the school system. There were 100 books. So we only were able, there was a lot of people that got called to do this. They only gave us 5 books that we had to translate to Spanish. Let me tell you, I got scarred for life. The things that I had to translate in this book, it was we spent probably a week that we were, my wife and I were uncomfortable with each other. We were a little angry. I just think we get along so well. We always together. We everywhere, but together, and we didn't understand what it was. It was, and then we hit it. We put a pen into it. It was those books. They
really?
Got so angry, just for me to be able to ask my wife. I said, because she will tell me I was doing something. She say, "Hey, how do you say this in Spanish?" I say, "What? Yeah, how do you say?" I said, "Let me read that thing," because I couldn't believe it. She was telling me this thing. I couldn't translate the books because I couldn't. I felt like I was doing something wrong. I felt like, how can we allow this to happen? These people should be locked up.
And now we're seeing it in Florida, where they're handing out books to 5-year-olds that are essentially child pornography.
It is. It is child pornography. It's child abuse. And I couldn't believe it. So think about, I am almost a 50-year-old man that's been around many countries all over the United States. I opened business. I've done a lot of things all over, everywhere. And I couldn't process this information. It was disturbing. I was there like, how would I process this information in my age? Now, think about if you give this information to a 9, 8, 7, 11, 12-year-old that is developing, their brain is actually having been developed completely. You confuse this person. You make them feel like a victim.
You're training them from a young age.
And it's all about the victim hook. Why? Because for this narcissist, it is so important that they create groups of individuals that always feel they're a victim of something. Mm-hmm. And society hate them for who they are. Because for this narcissist, socialism is the religion and the government is God.
Right.
So you start teaching these kids, okay, look everything hate you, but there's something here. It's going to always look after you. It's going to take care of you. What is it? The government. So those candidates are running campaigns on, we need to bring big government to take care of everybody. The communists today are the ones that these kids, one or maybe 2 generations, are going to walk straight to the polls and vote for a communist president. How? We're going to fix, Bill, I believe we're going to fix our voter integrity situation. People are more involved. Everybody's getting excited, The legislator's going to fix all these problems, whatever. But think about if we fix all that. And these kids one day become adults, they have children, they pass those children, those ideologies, and ideologies being passed from one generation to another, and then become the majority of the country. And I run, not me, but somebody run with this idea, say, elect me that I'll take care of everything for you. Just give me all the power.
And I agree with you, but I also think that they may have overplayed their hand with COVID. Because yes. COVID was a power grab. And let's just put it in reality. It was a power grab and a control grab. Mm-hmm. Okay, because if you get a 98% cure rate, I think that's not a big issue. However, what ended up happening, the unintended consequence, was parents started seeing what was being taught to their children. And they didn't like it. And now they're active, and they're now demanding control of school boards, and they're demanding the states to do what they need to do. And I don't think the left planned on that, and they overplayed their hand. So I'm confident that we're going to keep building on that.
Look, I am a very optimistic person, Bill. People like you and your fellows here, and myself and my wife, we're going to rise up. See, they're not going to do a takeover right now because they know. That will rise up and say, that's not happening. Not on our watch. So they're going to have to, but think about this. Okay, we get the school under control. But now it's not just there. It's our music. It's our TV shows. It's our news.
Our media.
It's all everywhere media, right. You go. Look, we got Disney World right now pushing all this nonsense to your throat. Go figure. We got over 100 major corporations in the United States teaching their employees diversity, equity, and inclusion.
Your and the products, US military, too.
The military is right now more concerned about wife fertility than teaching these soldiers
how to fight.
Look,
cross-dressing. Very important. Cross-dressing is a major military.
Hey, I was talking to some colonels last month from the Army. Retired colonels from the Army, and they were telling me that, Jonathan, we're probably going to be losing more than 100,000 soldiers because the mandates, that they're not going to do it. But they're doing this with the purpose to get rid of those people that believe in constitutional rights. So they'll eventually be replaced by these ones that don't care about that.
Mm-hmm. You see, now you're getting me in my own soapbox here because I'm a retired light colonel. And one of the things I've fought for years is I never liked the professional army concept. I've always believed in a citizen army.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and this died in the 70s when it used to be a requirement that basically you did 2 years of military duty for everybody. So everybody coming out at some point went to the military. You had a citizen soldier. And their mind was set. They knew what the military is about. But they still went back to the civilian world. It was not a professional army. An army is very good. I'm not arguing that point. But there's danger involved when they become their own elitist group. Mm-hmm. And I've always felt that we need to go back to the citizen soldier.
Back to basis.
Oh, of course, it's not going to be real popular telling 18-year-olds they need to go in the military.
Well, but you look at it this way. Look, I feel, and you know, I have political aspirations. I'm not going to say exactly what I'm running for here. Eventually, you will know exactly what I'm going to be running for office. But one of my platforms that I'm going to be running is going to be God is coming back to school. I don't care who get offended. I don't care if you don't like it. But we're going to start school by praying and the play of the Legion. And we're going to terminate, and I'm going to be an advocate for that. No more, and I repeat, no more sex education.
Yay.
Teach biology and maybe to compromise. Because I'm a compromiser. Yeah, right. I'm going to have sex education for the parents. Let the parents come every month, once a month, and let the teachers teach the parents. Let the parents see if they want to teach that garbage to their kids. There awesome. You have it.
Awesome.
That's a balance there.
TK, I think we've reached that point where it's time to pay a few bills. You with me on that, sir?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to take a short break while we pay a few bills so that we can continue this conversation. So we'll be back in a couple.
Veteran awareness sponsored by You Are Not Alone. Today's veteran homeless rate is approximately 19,750, and the numbers are declining because of the various veteran programs. If you are a veteran you know is homeless, please call 877-4-AID-VET. This is a confidential and toll-free call. From this veteran to other veterans, please be there to help our brother and sister veterans. Again, the number is 1-877-424-3838. And thank you for your service.
My name is Brian Wilson. I'm running for district court judge. During my lifetime, I've gone from protecting your God-given and constitutional freedoms as a combat vet of the U.S. military to working locally as a carpenter building homes while I work my way through college. For the past 17 years, I've been protecting and defending your constitutional rights in the courtroom. I'm currently protecting our rights of our most vulnerable, our children, as the guardian ad litem attorney advocate for the children of Brunswick, Columbus, and Bladen County. I've spent my career serving our country, our state, and our communities, so I ask that you continue your confidence by voting for me, Brian Wilson, in the primary elections on May 17th. Thank you.
This show is also sponsored by Dr. Tony Maglione. Dr. Tony is a cardiologist practicing in Wilmington. He accepts Medicare patients, and his office is located across the street from New Hanover Regional Medical Center at 2032 17th Street. The office number is 202-1071. Dr. Tony is an author whose last book is Rules for Conservative Patriots, and it can be purchased on Amazon. His website is www.drtony.com. drtonymag.com.
We need judges who serve we the people, not self-interested career politicians. This is Jenny Statting, wife of Judge Michael Statting, your conservative candidate for North Carolina Court of Appeals. Michael is a former prosecutor, sitting Republican judge, and a reservist in the United States Air Force. Michael is a lifelong public servant. That is why I'm asking you to remember to vote for Judge Michael Statting, your conservative candidate for North Carolina Court of Appeals. Paid for by the committee to elect Michael Statting. Michael Statting is a reservist for the United States Air Force. Use of job title does not imply endorsement by the Department of Air Force or the Department of Defense.
Our founders expected judges to apply, not make, our laws. I'm Trey Allen, conservative candidate for the North Carolina Supreme Court. More than 20 years ago, I began my legal career by joining the Marine Corps and taking an oath to support and defend the United States Constitution. As a justice on our state Supreme Court, I will continue to protect the Constitution by basing my rulings on the founders' intent, not my personal views. Paid for by Trey Allen for Justice.
Welcome back, everybody, to the second half of All Things Brunswick. We have a great conversation going on, talking about how we need to fix this country. And we're going to continue that conversation. We've paid a few bills. We're going to pay a few more at the end of the show. But in the meantime, Dan, you want to pick it up?
Yeah. So, Jonathan, I'm so glad you're here for this question. So one of the things I'm going to ask as the classic white American male is this. So we all know the border's wide open right now.
You're talking about the minority of this country right now.
Well, where I want to go with this is the Democratic Party's view is they're opening the border because they think they're going to have the Hispanic vote for centuries to come.
Not on my watch.
Well, that's where I'm going to go with this is I'm not very familiar with the Hispanic community. I'll be the first to tell you that. The few people that I do know that are part of it are actually extremely conservative. Do you think that this could end up backfiring on the Democratic Party because people such as yourself coming from countries led by dictators come here, see what you've accomplished? Do you think that they're going to fall in line with what the Democratic Party thinks, or do you think this could end up backfiring on them in a big way?
Well, like I say, people like myself are going to make sure that that doesn't happen. But in the same time, you know, I ran for city council. I became a threat to the Democratic Party. These people attack me like nobody ever been attacked for city council in Wilmington. Why? Because they saw in me a threat. Mm-hmm. They couldn't have somebody as loud and as direct and not afraid to say the things that a lot of politicians are afraid to say. Yeah. Yes, we are by nature very conservative. These people, this thing can shoot them on the foot. Mm-hmm. If people like myself start rising up and educating the Hispanic community to let them know, say, look, I am the vice chair for the North Carolina Republican Hispanic Coalition. My job right now is to hopefully open chapters all over the state to make sure we keep the state red. They never go purple and definitely never go blue. The Hispanic community is becoming, I believe, the 27% of the population in the United States. The numbers are growing.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They are.
So our job, like people like myself, had to be to educate our community, because if you even look the Hispanic news, are playing the same thing that the American news is playing, the English-speaking news is playing. They're liberal. Let's just say they're not liberal. They're leftist.
You mean Telemundo's not Fox?
all these Hispanic news networks are pushing the same propaganda that the leftist NBC, CNN are pushing into our communities by telling them the Republicans are racist and they need to vote Democrat because the Democratic Party are the people that care about you, you know, and all these things. And some people are falling into that nonsense.
Yeah, but you take a look at the fact, and you can comment on this, the Republican values line up very, very nicely with the Hispanic community, both here and those coming in.
Well, that was my point, too.
You know, you look about family, you look about religion.
Right.
It is perfect in line. Mm-hmm.
But that's when I come into place. Look, I have many conversations with Hispanics, and I tell them I am a Republican, and sometimes they're Democrat. I say, oh, well, that's good. So I started asking questions. The moment I start asking questions, you can always see their faces. Say what? So I tell them, look, well, you know, do you have children? Yeah, yes. How many children do you have? Well, I have a daughter. So when they answer they have a daughter, I say, well, would you be okay if I pointed out to a man there in the you know, in the group, okay to go into the bathroom with your daughter? They're like, what? Well, that's where they're born.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, say what?
Yep.
Oh, this is where these people want. Are you okay to take down our religion and change it to something completely you're not going to be able to recognize it by bringing homosexuality, bringing pedophilia, bringing abortion on the men? Are you? No, but that's what they want.
Yep.
And whenever they don't have a daughter and they have boys, I tell them, this is the kick that always get the Spanish, especially the father. Because we are very like, you know, things have to be in a way, no? I tell them, are you okay that your son experiment in homosexuality? That we let him try to be a homosexual to see if he like it or not? I say, are you out of your mind? I say, no, this is what they want. This is what they're pushing right now with the transgenderism movement in the school. And you can always see their faces. Hold on a second. So tell me more about what they're doing. And I always love it. I love it when I start going and telling them this, telling them that, telling them this. And let me tell you, the Hispanic community are not stupid.
No, they're not.
They're not. These Democrats are the stupid ones. Do you think that we're stupid? We're going to risk everything, our life, our culture, everything, chain everything to move here, thinking this was a racist country? We're back country.
Good point.
Mm-hmm. We're not stupid. As stupid as are these politicians. That's what they have to have. This is what you guys need to understand about the Marxists, right? They don't have great ideas, and they know it. So they had to create narrative. They had to create division. Because if you put them in a situation that they had to come out with great ideas, they will always lose 2-1 against a conservative.
Mm-hmm.
They will always lose
because
they don't have common sense. So they had to create narrative. They had to divide, you know, people so they can go and pander to all these people about, oh, don't worry, I'll take care of you. What are your problem? I got you. And that's how these people operate. They don't have great ideas. And the moment you catch to what they're doing, and that's, once again, one of my jobs right now, is to make sure that I expose everywhere I go what they're doing to our community. Mm-hmm. Because there's no way what do you do for a living?
I own a fitness center.
Okay, so you're well-educated on fitness.
Yep.
So let's see. We're in an area that nobody ever worked out before in their life. And then you hear me talking about, oh, I'm going to invent an exercise called the crawl. Oh, the bench press. I'm the inventor of that. And you know about that. Everybody in that group doesn't know about it. I'm just breaking down how this Marxist work.
Yep.
Because I grew up in a Marxist country. So you're there, and you're looking at me and say, wait a second, Jonathan. You might not say it because you're polite and you're a conservative. Look at me and say, you invented the bench press?
Yeah.
I say,
well, you're
kidding, older
right?
than you.
Yeah.
You didn't invent that.
I was doing bench presses before you
before
were born.
Before you were born. But this is how these people work. They invent everything, and you're going to listen to them, but I'm going to twist everything. So these people listen to me. Mm-hmm. So you have a job there. Mm-hmm. That's why I see myself today. You can be a bystander, let me fool all these people, or you can say something and expose who I am. Mm-hmm. In that point, I became a fraud.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we have to be. People like myself that recognize how these people behave, how they act, their intentions, we need to be the ones that expose who they are. So this is how these people are. They're very deceived with what they're doing. And we just got to make sure they're exposing. And I think their narrative is going to start collapsing little by little, but it's going to take time.
Do you think that, and this is my personal belief, mm-hmm. that the leaders of the left, I'll just leave it at that, mm-hmm. think, I believe they're so racist, they actually think, I'll use the Hispanic, but you could include the black, any minority population, just isn't intelligent enough to yeah. understand what is going on. But the reality is they do understand it. Yourself is a perfect example of that.
Well, I tell you one thing. Let's start pointing the fingers in the right direction. You just say, you just call me a minority, right?
Okay.
You are the minority. I'm not. White people are the minority in this country.
Yes.
So you should call it for what it is.
Yep.
Don't be afraid mm-hmm. to do that.
Great point.
You see how I'm not afraid to call it for what it is? So we have people, black and brown, in this country calling for, oh, we're oppressed. I say, wait a second. Going to see the guidelines in the local, state, federal government. I can go and apply for a job, and you can go with me, and they're going to look at me and give me priority because I'm brown. And mm-hmm. not to you because you're white.
Right.
Affirmative action is another way to see it. So I am not a minority. I don't know why people keep calling browns and black minority in this country.
They're the majority right now.
They are the majority.
They are.
And that we do have a systemic racist in this nation. Mm-hmm. But it's against white people.
I was just going to say, yep.
So see, we had to be able to grow some cojones pretty much, right? And start calling these things. Because if we don't do it, they're going to keep doing what they're doing.
Right.
Pushing these atrocities into our communities and wishy-washing history, reinventing history. This is what these people are doing, what we did in Venezuela. Right. You think about it, if we would have told real through history in Venezuela about communism and socialism, we would have Chavez in power or Maduro? Never. Because we stay away from socially as much as far as possible. But we didn't do that. Mm-hmm. So in this country right now, we need to make sure, see, they are right now reinventing history right in front of you.
They're rewriting it.
Rewriting.
Day by day.
Yep.
So what's happening? 40 years from now, what do you think is going to happen?
They're trying to pack the courts. They're trying to delete the Constitution as it was written. They are forming their own education programs. Mm-hmm. They are trying to
They're not educating. They're indoctrinating.
Right. And they're trying to implement gun control in a way that they think that we are doing ourselves a favor by turning them in. What is that called? The black law?
Yeah, let me tell you a little bit, okay? So what is the first thing that Hugo Chavez does when he comes into power?
Took the guns away.
He took the Constitution away.
Oh, the Constitution first. Yeah.
Because he said it was mm-hmm. racist, mm-hmm. and it was too old. Who do you hear?
Yeah, it's funny things? How we... Yeah.
That's what I can have an argument with anybody in this country. But I don't care how well-educated you are. I say, wait a second. I heard that garbage before. Yep. But I just, that little, you being a worker, and do you know so much about gyms and all that? I'm not going to pull one on you because you're going to know exactly, wait a second.
Right.
You can't pull one on me. I know about this. Right? So the same thing with these people. So I heard this before. I said, wait a second. Chavez did that. So that's a red flag to me, right? The first thing that Chavez does, nationalize the police. What do you think this defund the police movement is all about?
Oh, it's all about that. Mm-hmm.
Think about it. The crime is rising up. Our local police are not going to be able to handle the situation. They're going to start asking help to the federal government. It's already happening in Chicago, in New York, mm-hmm. in L.A.
Right.
So what are you're going to see some politicians, in order to end systemic racism and police brutality, we need to nationalize the police. So we can end all this problem. And we're going to be able to see what they're doing and catch them on the act. Whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. You know how these politicians do.
Oh, yeah, and they're definitely, I mean, the Capitol Police in D.C. now are getting offices throughout the country. They're
the FBI. What does the FBI stand for? The Federal Bureau of Investigation. Yeah. They're MIA. These people are not investigating a lot of things that I see and everybody in this country see.
Right.
Right? They became more political.
Very much so.
Actual law enforcement.
If you look at what's going on with the supposed kidnapping of Governor Whitman.
Yeah, exactly.
The reality is that the four people had never met that were supposedly guilty of this operation mm-hmm. until an FBI informant brought them all together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And two of the four have already been declared not guilty in a trial because of entrapment. Mm-hmm. And that's not getting out anywhere. So the FBI has become a political arm.
And you're seeing the same thing with
the
January
left.
6th.
Yes. Of the left.
Same thing came
up
there.
But you see that. So what did Chavez do after he nationalized the police? He gave us gun control.
Mm-hmm.
What do you see right now here? The red flag law.
Yeah.
And there's something new. Their president just came out with it. It's called, what is that?
Ghost guns.
Ghost guns, yeah. See, they're always looking for a way to disarm the population.
Right.
They had to find, in their presentation, for those people that are weak, those people that we creating in school, they don't have resilience. They're all weak. They're like always scared. Like, who's going to take care? Well, the government's going to be the one taking care of us. You start giving those type of presentation for the commander-in-chief, say, well, this is a gun and this is. Let's just remember these people. Criminals don't pull a permit to have a gun.
Exactly.
This gun control always hurt law-abiding citizens.
Correct.
So why so. We need to get better and to do a push back and be more in the offense, now always in the defense. We need to start changing how we act as a conservative. So this is something that everywhere I go, I talk
you.
About this. I talk about this a lot. This is how conservatives need to start thinking in this country and all over the world. God is first. Our jobs, our family second. Our job third. And politics four. The four things to make things to be better for you is if we start as a conservative thinking that way. Those four things.
Well, they depend on the fact that we all grew up in what we called a peaceful environment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mom and dad, and I was guilty raising my own kids. I really didn't want fairness. I wanted quiet. Mm-hmm. So whatever it took to settle everything down, that's
relate.
What
yep.
you did.
Yep.
And we grew up with the fact that we were to avoid conflict where possible. And the left plays on that.
Mm-hmm.
And they look for the conflict knowing that we will compromise and give away something. And they're more than willing to take 10 pieces of the pie till it gets the whole pie, you know, over 20 years, and we'll just back off and say, we'll give you this if you be quiet.
Exactly.
And we can't do that anymore.
We tend to compromise.
Right.
In the compromise, you know, when you compromise, I look at the compromise thing, and when I said earlier, I will compromise, I was being sarcastic, right? There's no compromising. It's got to be a two-way street. I give you something, and I want something in return. Now, I give you this, and then I'm not getting something in return. That's a horrible transaction.
And it's been going on for 40 years.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a one-way street.
It is.
No, I'm sorry. It's got to be a two-way street. Mm-hmm. Like I say, I would love, that's going to be one of my main things when I run for office. God's back in school. We're saying our play of religion before we start school. And we're going to teach sex education to parents, not to children. See, I'm compromising.
I like your
they compromise. Want it. They want sex education, right?
Yep.
Well, I'm not going to take it away from them. But we're going to teach the parents the sex education.
We'll teach the parents how to teach the kids.
Exactly. See the compromise?
Yep.
I'm not taking what they want so desperately. I'm going to let them have it. Right?
Right.
Right.
But it's going to be the parents, the ones that get the sex education.
And that's who should be doing it.
I think we have to do that.
Oh, commercial time?
Yeah. Are we, TK, how much time have I got to play with? Got 5 minutes of total. Okay.
Better
we have to pay a few bills right now, and then we'll be back to close. Hang on, people. We've had a great time, so hold on.
Like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning.
Veteran Awareness, sponsored by You Are Not Alone. Today's veteran homeless rate is approximately 19,750, and the numbers are declining because of the various veteran programs. If you are a veteran you know is homeless, please call 877-4-AID-VET. This is a confidential and toll-free call.
From this veteran to other veterans, please be there to help our brother and sister veterans. Again, the number is 1-877-424-3838. And thank you for your service.
My name is Brian Wilson. I'm running for district court judge. During my lifetime, I've gone from protecting your God-given and constitutional freedoms as a combat vet of the U.S. military to working locally as a carpenter building homes while I work my way through college. For the past 17 years, I've been protecting and defending your constitutional rights in the courtroom. I'm currently protecting our rights of our most vulnerable, our children, as the guardian ad litem attorney advocate for the children of Brunswick, Columbus, and Bladen County. I've spent my career serving our country, our state, and our communities, so I ask that you continue your confidence by voting for me, Brian Wilson, in the primary elections on May 17th. Thank you.
This show is also sponsored by Dr. Tony Maglione. Dr. Tony is a cardiologist practicing in Wilmington. He accepts Medicare patients, and his office is located across the street from New Hanover Regional Medical Center at 2032 17th Street. The office number is 202-1071. Dr. Tony is an author whose last book is Rules for Conservative Patriots, and it can be purchased on Amazon. His website is www.drtonymag.com.
We need judges who serve we the people, not self-interested career politicians. This is Jenny Statting, wife of Judge Michael Statting, your conservative candidate for North Carolina Court of Appeals. Michael is a former prosecutor, sitting Republican judge, and a reservist in the United States Air Force. Michael is a lifelong public servant. That is why I'm asking you to remember to vote for Judge Michael Statting, your conservative candidate for North Carolina Court of Appeals. Paid for by the committee to elect Michael Statting. Michael Statting is a reservist for the United States Air Force. Use of job title does not imply endorsement by the Department of Air Force or the Department of Defense.
Our founders expected judges to apply, not make, our laws. I'm Trey Allen, conservative candidate for the North Carolina Supreme Court. More than 20 years ago, I began my legal career by joining the Marine Corps and taking an oath to support and defend the United States Constitution. As a justice on our state Supreme Court, I will continue to protect the Constitution by basing my rulings on the founders' intent, not my personal views. Paid for by Trey Allen for Justice.
We have about 90 seconds left. I'm going to give that to Jonathan to summarize anything he can in that time. Jonathan, you got it.
Well, my final thoughts here to all my fellow Americans is that, in North Carolinians, remember, if this country falls, where will all go?
Love it.
Just think about that. We'll be able to go to Canada, Mexico? I don't think so. We're standing in the last domino of freedom in the world.
Yep.
And if this country falls, we can kiss all those freedoms for every hope in anybody in this world, goodbye. So make sure we stay active, get involved, and be patient. This fight is not going to be something that we're going to be able to win overnight. It's going to take time. But we got to come together and take our country back. Thank you so much.
Oh, I
Thank
love
you.
It.
Thank
I don't
you
think
so
we can
much.
Add a thing to that.
I don't know of
at all.
Thing I want
I'm just going
to
tell you that we've kind of worked out that he'll be back in a couple of weeks for part two of this event, and maybe 3, 4, and 5, and we'll just go home. And give him the mic.
I'm fine with that.
But anyway, it's time for us to say good evening and tune in next week for another great show. And in 2 weeks from now, he will be back.
Thank you so much.
This is
Thank
Bill
you
Moore.
So much for the invitation.
Dan Roman.
Mary Stillwell.
Have a good one and see you in a week.
See ya.
Thank you, guys. And I'm proud to be